"Stay here and keep alert with me." Then he went a short distance farther and fell on his face and prayed, "My Father, if it's possible, take this cup of suffering away from me. However, not what I want, but what you want." He came back to the disciples and he found them sleeping. He said to Peter, "Couldn't you stay alert for 1 hour with me? Stay alert and pray so that you won't give in to temptation. The spirit is eager, but the flesh is weak." And so a second time he went away and prayed, "My Father, if it's not possible that this cup be taken away unless I drink it, then let it be what you want." You notice the difference. First he said, "If it's possible, take this cup of suffering away from me." Secondly, he doesn't say if it's possible. He said if it's not possible that this cup can be taken away from me, then let it be. Again, he came and found them sleeping. Their eyes were heavy with sleep, but he left them and again went and prayed the same words for a third time. It's interesting because they weren't the same the first two times. He came to his disciples and said to them, "Will you sleep and rest all night? Look, the time has come for the human one, or the Son of Man, to be betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up. Let's go. Here comes my betrayer." Interesting that he says, to be betrayed into the hands of sinners. We think of this as the Romans, but he's speaking about the Jews who first take him. Let us reflect on these words with prayer. Almighty and everlasting God, pour out your Spirit on us. Make this word alive and real to us this day as we consider, reflect, and begin to practice what it means to be committed to our prayer life, committed to you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. So have you ever heard somebody say, you know, like, that happened in the blink of an eye, or it happened just like that? I was so curious that I Googled, how long does a snap last, you know? Within 1/100th of a second, you can hear a whole snap. And so I needed a longer duration because I needed 0.19 seconds, 1/19th of a second. So I got out my telephone and I used the stopwatch feature of it and tapped as quickly as I could. That was 1/16 of a second right there. What you just heard, is that thing on? Is this thing on? Here we go. Here, this is 1/16 of a second. In between those two taps, 1/19 of a second. Basically the same duration is how far behind Abby D'Agostino was to making the 2012 Olympics in the 5,000 meter. It's actually the closest 3rd, 4th, and 5th that's ever happened in an Olympic trial for the 5,000 meter. You can't turn these things on. This is, I might have to come back to this throughout this whole thing.
Okay.
1/19 of a second. That's how far behind she was making the 2012 London Olympics. I like that. Keep that thing on. Or I'm going to have to do it on this. It's going to be a lot louder. Is that messing you up? All right. 1/19 of a second. Many of us have seen these oh-so-close things. And we see runners and athletes fall on the ground. Oh. And we can assume for ourselves, maybe you've been in a similar position, that Abby had a choice at that point in time. She could go home distraught and defeated and give it up. I quit! I'm never running again. I was 1/19 of a second behind. Or, you know, they can go home and redouble their efforts and try to get back to the next Olympics. And some people live from Olympic to Olympic to Olympic. Some people actually don't even compete in many of the mid-year things simply because they're trying to get to the Olympics. So I actually saw this in cycling one year. When we were in Atlanta, we had NBC Sports, which was great because all I did that whole summer was watch NBC Sports. And it wasn't like the normal sports, which I don't really care for, football, basketball, just so they could compete and be in shape for the Tour de France. And so we find that some people did, well, Abby didn't take either of those approaches, you know, of either, you know, resting and trying to get, she went home because she was a sophomore at Dartmouth. Dartmouth is an Ivy League school up in New England. Some of you are familiar with it or understand, you know, Harvard, Yale, these are prestigious places. I actually was 17th in my class and thought of myself as fairly smart, and I never ever would have even come close to getting into Dartmouth. I had a friend, she went to Brown, which is another Ivy League school. She had a 1600 on her SAT, which was a perfect score. She missed one question out of all of them. That's what it takes to get into Dartmouth and Brown and Yale and Harvard. You have to be the cream of the crop, almost perfect. I was nowhere even close. And so Abby went back to Dartmouth and continued running. And that year, she actually placed first in the Ivy League cross country meet, which is a 6K. She then placed second in the NCAA cross country meet. And then she went on to run the whole gamut of indoor and outdoor track long distance running by winning first in almost every event, the 5,000, the 3,000, the 1,500. She sweeped them all and got first, not only in the Ivy League, but also in the NCAA, which means she was faster than every other female athlete that was out there for the whole year. And not only that year, but she went on to repeat her performance again the next year, winning in 2013 first in the cross-country meet as well. Every year, she improved. Her freshman year, she got third in the NCAA cross-country meet. Her sophomore year, she got second. And her junior year, she got first in the NCAA cross-country meet. Extraordinary female athlete, and everybody knew that she was extraordinary. Now, that would be an achievement in and of its own, except because she was at Dartmouth, she also had to do the whole Ivy League class thing. She got a 3.73 cumulative GPA her junior year. I didn't come anywhere close to that in college either. This is an extraordinary athlete, and so much of an extraordinary athlete and scholar that she was awarded for 2 years running the Scholar Athlete of the Year in track and cross country, indoor and outdoor track. So she won three Scholar Athletes of the Years that sophomore year. An extraordinary athlete. It would be enough just to talk about her as an extraordinary athlete, except there's more to Abby D'Agostino's story. In 2015, she did an interview with a podcast. Is anybody unfamiliar with what a podcast is? I need hands. John Jr., I just learned his new name. John has no clue what a podcast is. A podcast is like a radio broadcast, but it happens on the internet. So what usually happens is I want to start a podcast, I start interviewing people and recording it and posting it out on the internet. She did this in a radio format podcast where it was just an interview, an hour-long interview with another runner. And the podcast is called Running on Om. For any of you who have any Eastern history, Om would be like a Hindu thing, Om. And Abby actually talked about her Christian faith for an hour on this broadcast and how it related to her track appearances. And she talked about the struggles that came along with it. She mentioned that a pastor had preached on Sabbath and how it automatically clicked for the first time in her life that Sabbath had so many incredible connotations. And namely, what I was most impressed with was not only is it a rest for us because God rested, but it's also a chance for us to give back to our neighbors. So what a wonderful concept. If she's spending 6 days a week studying for herself, running for herself, that on the seventh day, her break might not actually be to not work, but to give to others, to be generous with others. So she began to practice this idea of Sabbath as yes, a day of restoration and renewal and reflection on what her performance had been throughout the whole week. She reflected through prayer and meditation on her running performance, on her academic performance, and then she would go out and do something about it. She'd go out and give back to her community. I found this fascinating. She continued to talk to this interviewer all about her faith and how it related to running, and how her prayer time informed all of these things. She said that she would get up every morning, because she's still in Ivy League college and she still had to do things like go to class in the morning. So she'd get up early and have her breakfast with her roommates, and then go into her room and lock herself in her room and read some scripture and journal a little bit and just be present and listen. She was asked if she used any sort of devotional. She said, actually, sometimes those things can fill up your head so much that you can't be present with God. And so she'll just read scripture on her own and just sit there and reflect on what it means. And she said, sometimes I miss this time. And I can actually tell when I miss this time by my behavior throughout the rest of the day. I'll be driving down the road and at a stoplight and the light turns green and the person in front of me doesn't go. And so I start honking on the horn and I have to stop and be like, why am I in such a hurry? It's not the city's fault that the light isn't turning green, or it's not this person's fault in front of me that they're not going. And she realized that this morning activity of prayer is actually what grounded her in being patient and kind with others, of being a little bit more empathetic with others, being a little bit more empathetic with herself and not harming herself as much, and being able to say, you know what, I did really well today, this was good. It grounded her in who she was, and it grounded her in who God was, and it grounded her in who her neighbor was. She talked about her transition into faith. Her family was not born and raised Christian, but her parents came to the Catholic faith when she was young and began to. She said she noticed her parents change. I thought that was a beautiful statement. She noticed her parents change and become something new, become something better. And so she wanted to do that. She pursued God. But what was fascinating is she was asked about, you know, being changed by God, and she said, God had been pursuing me long before I was pursuing God. This is a wonderful Methodist theology right here, even though she's Catholic, and some of you might know, we're actually from the Catholic tradition, so we received it, but God was pursuing her, and God was pursuing us long before we started pursuing God. God was working in our lives long before we knew. And so, when she realized that God was pursuing her, she began to pursue God in return. She had some race anxiety, and so she actually started journaling about this and writing about it. And what she ended up saying was that her faith in God is what caused her to reach this point where she could say, no matter how this race turns out, God strengthened me to be here, and God will strengthen me as I leave here. So it's fascinating then that with a couple of personal bests, not only did she sweep the NCAAs for 3 years, she came back and became a professional athlete in 2015, and she went back and qualified for the 2016 Olympics in Rio. And so I'm going to show you a video, and it's her qualifying race for the final round in the 5,000 meter, which is about 3 miles. Her personal best in this is this is for the 1,500 meter. Her personal best in this is 4 minutes and 8 seconds. 4 minutes and 8 seconds to run almost a mile. Can you do that? It's just under a mile. 1,600 meters is a mile. So she's running just under a mile in 4 minutes. The women's record right now is about 3:96. Hers is 4:08. So this is what happens at the Olympics in Rio, 2016.
So we're just about all set for the second heat in the women's 5,000 meters. All eyes will be on Almaz Ayana, a new world record holder over 10,000 meters. Nikki Hamlin there, she's had a Commonwealth medal over the years. D'Agostino of the USA giving the camera a little wave. Two heats, five fastest loser spot.
Ayana is now leaving the back straight, and the rest of the pack has just entered the back straight. Oops. Robinson fall at the back of the field here. There's a couple of runners down. And the other athlete who's fallen has decided to stop back there with her. And she is in a lot of trouble, D'Agostino.
It's D'Agostino and Nikki Hamlin. Hamlin stumbles on the inside line and then a really nasty fall and an ankle problem there for D'Agostino.
The American was initially showing more concern and then realised how much pain she was in.
D'Agostino is going to finish this race. It's going to be a very, very painful mile for the American. Brave, brave performance to carry on. D'Agostino is being passed now by Almazayana. It really will be an emotional finish to her race, which will come way after the top five qualifiers. Abby D'Agostino, tears of frustration, and maybe hopefully one day she will look back on this as a moment of great pride, embraced by the woman whose aspirations also came to an end, the ankle clearly hurting. But she decided to finish the race, and that is the very embodiment of the Olympic spirit, alive and well here in Rio in 2016.
Stopped after she got back up, went back. Amanda Agostino's faith changed the behavior of another athlete. So much so that the Olympic Committee permitted both of them to run in the final. I'm convinced that if Nikki Hamlin hadn't turned back to help Abby as well, that she wouldn't have been given that spot. And Nikki Hamlin didn't have a clue that the International Olympic Committee was going to come back and afford her a place in the final. But Abby D'Agostino's faith changed the way that Nikki Hamlin behaved. And what's fascinating is that long before Abby D'Agostino ever did this, she was changed. And I want to argue today that she was changed by her faith through prayer. Abby D'Agostino spent every morning in prayer, remember? And when she didn't get to pray, she was a different person in traffic. Some of you have been there, right? A wonderful piece of wisdom from the monastic tradition about prayer is this. The first person prayer changes is me. Oftentimes we pray, God, my mother's got cancer, please fix her. God, I just need to pass this test. God, I just need a job. God, fix this circumstance. What Abby D'Agostino clearly realized long before she hit that 2016 Olympics is that prayer changes me. When asked if she remembered falling the second time, she did not. She didn't even really remember that she had helped out Nikki Hamlin all that much. It was instinctual. It was her prayer life had made her behavior so instinctual that she barely even realized what she was doing when she did it. She could have just left Nikki and then realized that she was hurt, but she didn't. Because prayer had changed Abby D'Agostino long before she ever hit the 2016 Olympics. And she's being celebrated all over news media. And she's proclaiming the gospel of Jesus all over news media. All because of her prayer life. Now, each of us is in a different season of our lives. And we're not going to be Olympic athletes. But that doesn't mean that we're not in a race, as Paul says. And it certainly doesn't mean that we finished the race. Because every single one of us wants to finish this race strong. Even if we do it crawling. Even if we were injured along the way. There's no race to run if you don't have a prayer life. And quite frankly, if your prayer life only consists of petitioning God to fix something in your life or the life of somebody else, that's not a prayer life. That's a me life. If you are the subject of most of your prayers, remember, you need to pray more because the first person in your prayers are going to change is you. And what Abby does is not just sit down there and say, God, fix this, fix that, fix this. She said she sits in quiet and takes a small piece of scripture and waits for God to speak to her through that scripture. This is prayer. Yes, prayer is petition. But we also all need a vital prayer life where we spend not talking and telling God what God needs to do, but listening to what God is inviting us to do so that when the chance comes, we are already prepared to stop what we're doing, to turn back, and to offer our lives for someone else. Not knowing that they might just do the exact same thing for us right after we've done it. Not expecting it. Not expecting a place in the final. Simply doing what God has called us to do. Abby D'Agostino is the embodiment of a life of prayer. And I want you to consider what training you need to do to become as committed to your faith as she is to her running practice. I want each and every one of us to consider what it would be like, you know, like if you're lifting weights, tomorrow I'm going to lift 5 pounds more. And set a goal by next year, this time, weight, and I'll be lifting 25 pounds more than I ever could before. I'm going to set new personal records. What does that look like in your prayer life? To set a goal and start making some PRs, personal records. What does it look like to stop begging God to fix your life and start asking God to speak into your life? As Christians, we need to become more committed to praying. And that's not just praying for me, and it's not just praying for the people I like, but as Jesus reminds us, it's to pray for our enemies. Not so that they will just magically get better. If you're asked to carry a soldier's backpack a mile, carry it too. Carry it an extra mile. The title of this film is called The Extra Mile. Abby ran a good long while on a torn ACL. And the question for each of us is, I gotta get to work, I gotta get the kids ready. Yeah, we've all got things that are fine for our time. In this season, as we prepare for New Year's resolutions and everything else that's about to happen, Thanksgiving's gonna be crazy, Christmas is gonna be crazy. How are you gonna commit yourself to being more prayerful? And who will you commit yourself to be accountable to? Abby D'Agostino, as a professional runner, still has a coach who's pushing her. Who's going to push you and hold you accountable? Make sure, did you pray this morning? Did you spend at least a couple minutes in prayer where you weren't asking for anything, where you were just listening? How did your prayer change you today? Oh, you missed your prayer life? What's not going well today that you've noticed? We've become a little bit individualistic in our faith, and everything I ever do, preach, and say is going to invite you to become more communal. Because that's the gospel. How do we come together and learn from one another and strengthen one another? Most of you know that your marriage, you're a better person because of your marriage. You became stronger when you united with that person. And so as a church family, we're uniting together. How are you going to commit yourself to prayer? Who will hold you accountable? And what will that look like? Over the next four more weeks, we're going to explore more topics just like this. And at the end of this, you're going to have an opportunity to really concretely put into words what your commitment is. So I want you to seriously reflect on this. Write it down like Abby D'Agostino does in a journal. And start living into it. Put it at the top of the page, I'm going to pray twice every day. And one of those times is just going to be in silence. And keep a record as to whether you did that or not. It's not like,